The outlook for St. Joseph County, next on Economic Outlook.
I'm Phil D'Amico. Whether we're exploring Michiana's business environment, our community at large, or covering the region's complex economy, Economic Outlook is where we explore the economy, education, manufacturing, and new business models. My job is to go beyond the numbers and corporate analysis as we invite some of the best experts to answer the hard questions that face our economy. This is Economic Outlook.
A portion of Economic Outlook is underwritten by Northern Indiana Workforce Board and Partners for Workforce Solutions, and by the Progress Club, offering women of all ages an opportunity to develop lifelong friendships, challenge the mind, and work for the welfare of children and families.
Hello, I'm Phil D'Amico, Director of Business Growth for the Chamber of Commerce of St. Joseph County and your host for Economic Outlook. Today we'll look at the results and future impact of the mayoral elections in St. Joseph County. We'll talk about business, economics, and vitality, and how the two mayors can work together to bring business and quality of life to our region. Joining us in the studio today are Mishawaka Mayor Dave Wood and South Bend Mayor-elect Pete Buttigieg. Gentlemen, welcome to the show. First off, congratulations. As I mentioned to you off the air, it's great to see you in person and not your campaign ads on TV. So it's great to have you.
Thanks,
and again, congratulations. I'm sure a lot of hard work. And I want to get to something which I hear a lot in the community, guys, is that kind of a youth movement among some of the key leadership in our community. Certainly with the two of you now, it will be as mayors, and then Jeff Ray at the Chamber of Commerce and all the economic development folks. You know, that's kind of added to a lot of energy and enthusiasm. Pete, maybe comment a little bit about maybe where you see the future of our county.
Sure. I think it was a great thing that a lot of young people have been involved, and we've just got new leadership in so many key posts in the community. The mayor's offices, also the chamber, Convention Visitors Bureau has new leadership. The schools are deciding who will lead the South Bend School Corporation. Just all throughout the community, we got a lot of new folks coming online, and I think for people who've been working on these problems for a while, hopefully a sense of renewal and maybe a chance to try new things. So I love my timing and I love the atmosphere right now.
Yeah, a lot of energy, Mayor, in our community.
Absolutely. I was one of the youngest mayors in the state. I didn't get to be young around here very long, so I'm looking forward to working with you, Pete, and definitely great to see the excitement that you've brought to the campaign. And so, we've just have so much potential here, and I think some fresh perspectives. I think we'll just, we're looking very forward to the future.
Yeah, and the good news is you won. I guess the bad news is now we've got to look for measurables and results, and I'm sure they'll come hard and heavy, but maybe give us a sense, Pete. You know, every time I'm in the community, we talk about jobs being one of the top issues. Certainly from a business outlook, I think any economist you talk to say moderate growth at best next year. Give me some of how some of those challenges can be combated.
Well, we know what we're up against. We're in a tough national climate, we're in a tough regional climate, and that's going to be the case for a while. But that doesn't mean that we can't move forward or have anything to look forward to. I think what we're going to see here is a chance to really take ownership of the future of the economy. We're facing a big structural adjustment. You know, a generation ago, it really was about having the biggest companies, companies that measure their employees in the thousands, trying to get them to locate here. We got a lot of companies now, they're smaller, they're more likely to have maybe 100 people, 200 people,
absolutely,
if that. But that's where a lot of the growth is. And not only are they often more nimble growing companies, but these are companies that are exporting goods outside the region, right, outside the country, and bringing in income to the region.
Yeah, in Indiana, one of the top states in the nation with exporting, about 20% mm-hmm. of our goods go across the world. Mayor, give me a sense of what were some of the key issues that you heard from your constituents, certainly the residents and citizens of Mishawaka, and maybe look at from the business outlook, how do we combat some of those things?
Well, certainly economic development, jobs is always a top tier issue, and certainly was during this campaign. But as I talked about, I think we have great potential. We're already starting to see, I think, an upturn, whether it's on a local level more so than on the national level, but we're starting to see a more of a sense of optimism. We're starting to see a lot of those companies that Pete talked about experience some growth. So it's the smaller companies that are adding 2, 4, 6, 10, 20 jobs. And so those add up, we're not getting the, you know, the big employer come in with 200 jobs that makes the big splash announcement, but we are seeing those smaller companies add staff right now. It's pretty encouraging.
Yeah, and gentlemen, I want to get your thoughts on this. I was actually at a summit today on, we had some economists looking at Indiana, looking at our region, talked about the fact that in Indiana, over the last, since the downturn, we've lost about 70,000 manufacturing workers. However, today we could hire 20 to 30,000 of those people back statewide if they had the skills.
Right.
K-12 education is a big issue. You know, the post K-12 education, another issue. Schools like Ivy Tech are going to play a major role. Pete, where do you see this helping our region? Where do we need to focus some of our efforts in this area?
So this all comes back to that structural adjustment I was talking mm-hmm. about. The days of us producing the cheapest goods are over,
right.
But we're still making things. Mm-hmm. The trick is for us to be competitive, those things have to be advanced and sophisticated. And that means that the workers making them also have to be advanced and sophisticated. A lot of times as I've been on the campaign trail, visiting different businesses, getting to know some of the different decision makers, I would hear the same thing over and over again. They'd say, you know, I would be growing faster if I could find more people ready to work here. Now, when you look at unemployment and how many people are looking for a job, and you look at that, you feel the sense of this huge disconnect. And then the question becomes, how do we get that matching function right. better performed? And just as you said, a lot of it goes to community and vocational mm-hmm. colleges. A lot of it goes back into the K-12 system. These employers, they're not necessarily looking for PhDs. They're looking for high school graduates or associate's degree holders, but ones that are really prepared to handle the sophisticated processes that it takes now, because mm-hmm. you could be on the shop floor of a sheet metal factory and you're not banging on a bit of metal with a mallet right. anymore. You're operating incredibly sophisticated machinery.
Absolutely. And what's interesting, we talked about Indiana, one of the worst states in the nation for average median wage at about $38,000 a year. Part of that is because of those 30,000 workers that are in manufacturing today, because of the technology, make $20 to $23 an hour, which drives obviously your income up. You brought up a great point, which I want to touch on. We've got about 13,000 businesses in our MSA region. About 11,900 of those have less than 30 employees. You talked about it, and I thought it was a great point about 2 and 4. Are there enough entrepreneurial initiatives that are going to help spur some of that growth in small business to help job growth?
You know, we do definitely see an entrepreneurial spirit, especially when an economy takes a turn like it has. People are maybe laid off and looking to do something else. And a friend of mine called me up just today looking to go off on his own and start a business. He's going through some of the programs that are available here through Chamber and such. But we definitely need to cater to that. We need to have that entrepreneurial spirit as a region. And we need to, education's obviously very key to that, preparing a workforce for tomorrow and people who understand that, you know, the risk is something that you work through, but hopefully we can have an environment that rewards that risk.
Right. That friend wasn't Jeff Ray, was it? Hopefully. We
no.
want to keep him at the chamber for a little longer anyway. You know, Pete, one of the things we talk about regionalism. Both of you guys have talked about kind of the regional approach and job creation across the region. How do we market this region? I don't know if we've ever really fully branded, marketed. I think that's got to be certainly a priority, whether it's you two getting together with the chamber, whoever. But the marketing plan of our region's got to be a key issue moving forward.
You're right, and region is the key word.
Right.
You know, I'm going to be responsible for South Bend, and I love South Bend, and I care about South Bend. But how much easier is it to sell mm-hmm. the context that South Bend and Mishawaka and the rest of our cities are part of? If I'm talking to the wider region or the wider mm-hmm. country or the wider world, trying to attract individuals and business opportunities, I would love to be able to sell something a little bit bigger than one city, to be able to talk about our proximity to the orthopedic centers mm-hmm. of excellence in Warsaw, our proximity to Lake Michigan
right.
on the Michigan side of the border, being around Chicago, having all the different manufacturing capacities of Elkhart together with the quality of life and other abilities that we have in the universities, of course, right. Colleges and universities that we have in the South Bend Mishawaka area. All of those things stitch together into a much bigger picture. And I think we need to learn to think that way and have really a positive sum mm-hmm. rather than zero sum outlook when it comes to how we right. relate to each other. And it's one thing I'm very eager to work with Mayor Dave on sure. and a lot of our decision makers here in the area.
Yeah, and we talk about economic development today has gone from the three I's, inventory, infrastructure, incentives, to really the P's, people, place. We talked about people and in having a skilled workforce, people, place, and position. Place is critical. How does the work environment feel? You know, how do we get along with our councils, school boards, all those things? That's a key issue, is setting up our place to be business friendly, I would think.
It is. We definitely want to have an environment that is business friendly, conducive for economic growth, and obviously cooperation with our governments, our neighbors is key to that, but having a great infrastructure is right. part of that, and that's something that we strive to work on all of the time and improve. We're in a community that's 180 years old in our city, and we've got some pretty old infrastructure in places, so we constantly strive to make sure that we're updating that, to make sure that we're capable of servicing our business community in a way that that helps them grow, and so that's something that we strive to do as well.
Sure. And, you know, we talk about people, place, and then position is one of the P's in there. Are we positioned for the future, and what is our position of the future? I've got to believe that a lot of the research and development in Notre Dame is a big part of that, probably not the only tool in our toolbox, but that's got to be a huge issue for us.
Absolutely. For the long run, it's incredibly mm-hmm. important. And we also have a great moment. Another one of the reasons I love my timing is that Notre Dame has shown a new level of interest in the well-being of the community. I think they recognize how much they have at stake mm-hmm. In South Bend. And so as I'm trying to think strategically about how institutions like Notre Dame and IU and our community colleges can all fit in here, it's great to know that we're going to have partnership at the other side of the table. We've got to gear up for an increasingly competitive right. economy, and that means we have to be competitive when it comes to not just our infrastructure, which is critical, but also our human infrastructure, our human capital. And that means attracting and retaining good people, and it means equipping the people we've got with the skills they need to succeed.
Sure. You know, I often get asked about, you know, when I go to these economic development conferences, they ask me, what's your elevator speech for your community? First off, I try and tell them I don't get in elevators with strangers, but that aside, what would be an elevator speech for our community, Mayor, if you had to look forward and looking out, what would be our position for the future?
Well, we are, as Pete mentioned, we are located in a great area, close proximity to cities such as Chicago, resources such as Lake Michigan, great transportation connections. We have great people here. That's the number one resource of our community. We have a great cost of living, and we have a very livable community. We have an enormous amount of educational opportunity with all of the colleges and universities that are already here. We have just an awful lot to offer anybody who's looking to this
sure.
area.
Yeah, and we talk about vitality of our region, Pete. I'm thinking with some of the youth that we talked about and some of the new energies and enthusiasm, boy, we really need to find a way to engage and retain and then even grow our young professional network here.
Absolutely. Obviously, I have something personally at stake
sure.
in having a lot of young professionals doing well here. One of the things that motivated me to get involved here in local politics was a sense that so many of the people that I grew up with would be here still if there were more economic opportunities
sure.
for them. If we get it right, I think we'll be able to take advantage of resources downtown, resources in our universities to make this a more attractive place for young people. And I think if we get it right, actually, there will be two barometers of how we're doing. One of them will be young people.
Mm-hmm.
Another will be retirees. When you right. think about retirees, a lot of times they're the full-time consumers of the kinds of cultural and commercial opportunities that I'd be taking more advantage
right.
of if I had time.
Right.
And so if we get it right, I think we'll see more young professionals, but also more retirees wanting to locate closer to the heart of our communities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we've seen that, Mayor, and certainly Mishawaka is a great example. Kind of a reurbanization, kind of revitalizing our downtowns, fixing those up, making them more conducive for our young professionals. Are you guys still working on that as a city, Mishawaka?
Absolutely. We one of the things that we strive to do is to be a community that you live, work, raise your family, and retire in. And so we want to have opportunity and options for the entire life cycle. And so that's what we work on. We have a great urbanization effort going on in our city right now. We have just housing options for all spectrums. We have affordable housing right next to housing that sells for $300,000-$400,000 along our river, and so we're building a population into our downtown that can take advantage of the local businesses, the services that are there, and so it's paying off. Having that livable downtown, livable community is great for all of us.
And where do you, Pete, see the river? I think one of the greatest assets we have in our community is the river. Sometimes I hear one of the least utilized in our certainly in South Bend. Where does that fit on your list of priorities?
It's crucial. You got to think back to the history of how our built environment got to be the way it is. You know, at the time that a lot of our buildings went up, the river was where you put things you didn't want to see again, especially if you were a factory.
Right.
Now it's very different. The river is really a center for recreation. It's appealing. People want to live close to water. They want to live close to the downtown area. And so we got to make sure, first of all, that we remember it's there. I think sometimes we forget that the very name of our city, South Bend, has to do with the geographical feature in the river. But also that we make sure that as we're thinking about new structures taking shape downtown, that we turn and face the river instead of turning our back to it. Because it is a terrific resource, not just for residential space, and we've seen more and more of that, but I want to see more commercial and retail opportunities there. I want to see that coffee shop, that restaurant, that bar that overlooks the river, because I know I'd enjoy hanging out there, and I think a lot of other people would too.
Absolutely. You know, neighborhoods get a lot of talk. Certainly, it's a key area in the South Bend region, maybe not as big in Mishawaka, although revitalizing some neighborhoods that may be a little blighted or more run down. Where does neighborhoods fit in your strategy in your next 4 years?
It's absolutely critical. One of the things that make our city livable is that we have clean and safe neighborhoods, and so that's always a priority and a goal to stay proactive in dealing with some of the issues that in our older neighborhoods it might be abandoned or vacant housing, and so we address that very aggressively, and we save what we can save, we tear down and rebuild what needs to be rebuilt. We have a great housing program that for first-time homebuyers that I think is one of the finest you'll find in the region. But it's also that infrastructure in older neighborhoods too, that really, what we see is when we put a little investment into an older neighborhood, it gets contagious. You see homeowners then start to put a little more pride and a little bit more effort into their own home, and it snowballs.
And this might go hand in hand, Pete. Neighborhood revitalization, a big issue. Also, crime has gotten certainly some discussion as well. Very, very two difficult opportunities for you as you come into office. Where do you see some of those things going?
Well, there's certainly a relationship between the two. If you have a neighborhood that's got a lot of vacant and abandoned structures, you're likely to see a lot more crime taking place there. It's a kind of a platform or a haven for a lot of criminal activity. Again, you have to look at our history. We're a city that lost about a quarter of our population compared to 1960. Now, the good news is that stabilized. We're not bleeding like that anymore. But we're still dealing with some of the legacy of that, and it means we got a housing stock that's just a little bit out of whack with where the population is. As Dave said, if you can save it, save it. We got some beautiful old structures here. And the first priority is to try to get these structures rehabilitated and get families living in them and get them back on the tax rolls. But if not, and they have to go, let's be strategic about it. What I really want us to start doing is look at abandoned structures one block or one area at a time instead of one house at a time, and try to be really tactically smart about where we concentrate our efforts. Because you're right, it's contagious, the good and the bad. If you have a problem, that'll be contagious. If you're making progress, that'll be contagious. And that feeds back into the issue of crime and safety.
Right.
That's a matter of having, you know, something as simple as just having people around. People traffic deters crime because you know that there are a lot of folks around and they have your back. And that's true whether we're talking about a neighborhood, making sure that's at the proper density, or whether we're talking about the downtown area and making sure people feel comfortable as they walk a block or two from a car to a restaurant to a venue.
Mm-hmm. And really interestingly enough, St. Joe High School will have a new downtown high school. First time in a while that South Bend will have a downtown high school. Where do you see that fitting in as it pulls maybe some of the things going on at Eddy Street along with your downtown South Bend?
You know, if we get it right, what will be happening in that neighborhood is a kind of a gravitational pull, so that a lot of folks who may have only slightly tiptoed into our community by wandering over to Eddy Street might actually have occasion to come a little further downtown. A lot of the families that go to St. Joe High School, where it is now, rarely have occasion to come into the heart of South Bend. Now they do. Question is, are we ready? Is the area around St. Joe High School poised for the kind of commercial and cultural activities, whether it's a you know, something for kids to do after school, or something for families to do when they're there for a game, or something for parents to do when they're waiting to pick up or drop off kids there? I think the answer now is not yet, but we've got to get there, and I think we can.
Yeah, we do. Your areas of emphasis, maybe looking at areas of potential growth, you're going to start your really official first full term as mayor. What are going to be some of your hot spots? Where do you see some of your areas that you're going to focus on right away?
Well, you know, I've been encouraged over this past year to see a lot of growth in our downtown. We're seeing just a number of business, the little shops, the small, whether it's a bar and grill, a coffee shop, a restaurant, open up in the older part of our downtown. I'm particularly encouraged by that. We think we have great potential with the former Unioil site along our river, and maybe doing an Eddy Street Commons type of a project in that area there. We're doing a lot of road work, infrastructure improvement through our main corridor, our main Church Street corridor, which will open up in about a week. And so that'll be a continue to be a hot spot. We think that our medical campus located on our north side will continue to grow over the coming years. We are building new infrastructure out there, roads and such, so that we can have buildable lots ready to go. And also the Capitol Avenue corridor is really, I think, the next future phase of growth for our city as well.
Yeah, it's amazing. I moved out here in 99, and just the changes from then, the city of Mishawaka looks completely different today than it did in 99. So a lot of great things going on there. Obviously, you take office on January 1. Boy, I looked at my calendar. That's not too far away. I don't know if you've looked at that recently, but it's not that far away. Give me a sense of what does a transition look like from now till then. It's almost going to be like a track meet, I'm sure.
It is definitely a sprint. You know, they say that to do great things, you need two things, a plan and not quite enough time. That's how it feels right here. But, you know, my priority is to, first of all, sharpen the details of the vision that I laid out in the campaign into a very detailed, very actionable plan so that we can come in on day one with some specific steps and some specific measures to hold ourselves accountable for how we're doing on all the things we talked about, whether it's economic development or whether it's customer service for the city. The other priority, of course, is to assemble a team of top-notch people who can deliver on that vision. And I have no doubt that we can get a terrific team up and running. We're going to be running pretty fast and hard, but it also feels that there's a lot of excitement in the community, that the community is really rooting for our administration to succeed. And I think we'll have to cash in on that as we ask the community to join with local government to move this community forward.
Yeah, and I'm going to ask Pete this question in a second, but how he talked about measurables and success. At what point do you know that you've hit those measurables and success? How quickly do you start to see some of those things unfold?
You know, it's an ongoing process, and we don't stop to measure so much as maybe we should at some points in time, but we continually strive to make progress, and that is to continue to build our infrastructure, to continue to invest in our city, and we see progress in the form of economic growth during economic times of struggle, which we've had. We've seen new companies come into our community, look to build where they might not have if we weren't doing those things to invest in our community. And so we just continue on with that. We don't put plans on hold because of campaign seasons. Right. We continue on to do what's in the best interest of our city, irregardless of politics and elections.
Yeah, and Mayor Wood brings up a great point, Pete, in the fact that we don't celebrate enough, or we don't communicate our victories enough. Social media is a big part of this now. How do you plan on utilizing maybe social media to get some of these small victories out?
You know, social media is a great tool, and I think we can use it both to solicit feedback from citizens and to share some of the things that that we consider really important or want to raise awareness of. It's always been important in my life. I can remember actually when Facebook got started. when I was in college, and you know, we've used it a lot in the campaign. But you know, a lot also depends on more old-fashioned ways of just talking to people face to face. And mm-hmm. so I think we'll be doing well if I'm out and about in person with department heads, speaking to citizens in different corners of the city about what they see going right and mm-hmm. what they think needs work.
What's one of the first things you're going to do when you hit office?
We're going to continue to do what we've done. I stepped into office replacing Mayor Jeff, and I had zero transition time.
I'm sure you had to clear up all that mess. Believe me, I know it now. I'm going to pay for that on Monday, by the way. So.
He left one day, I stepped in the next day, and right. So no transition time. But the value of this past year is that I really immersed myself in the operations of the city. Mm-hmm. And so, continuing on with that record of success that we've had over decades is something that we'll continue to do. We've got a proven formula for success in Mishawaka. We will continue down the path to doing what's made us Great. Successful in the past.
30 seconds we have left, Pete. Give me just a quick sense of what are you going to be focused on when you take office?
Well, you know, we've been talking about the economy today mm-hmm. and throughout the campaign,
right.
and that's going to take a lot of energy and attention.
Sure.
We've got to get all the basics right in terms of city services, safety, mm-hmm. But also we can't ever lose sight of the economic issues at hand, and mm-hmm. I think there's a chance to really do something about that and use this office as a way to pull people together.
Great. Well, guys, I've never felt so old in my life. I got two young guys here, but no, congratulations to both of you again. I wish you the very best, and certainly call me if you need me, I guess would be the best appropriate phrase. But good luck and best wishes to you guys as you venture into these next 4 years.
Thank you. It's great having you. Thanks, Will.
That's it for this edition of Economic Outlook, the show that puts focus on key business, education, and community elements that drive our regional economy. I'm Phil D'Amico. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on Economic Outlook.
A portion of Economic Outlook is underwritten by Northern Indiana Workforce Board and Partners for Workforce Solutions, and by the Progress Club, offering women of all ages an opportunity to develop lifelong friendships, challenge the mind, and work for the welfare of children and families.
This WNIT local production has been made possible in part by viewers like you. Thank you.